Hi, welcome back to Understanding Gradle. Today, I'd like to talk about declaring dependencies in Gradle. So this is the first video in the area of dependency management, which is something you'll have to deal with if you work with Gradle. Understanding dependency management in Gradle is important for structuring your own projects into components, but also when you want to reuse existing libraries and need to upgrade them and deal with their versions. The dependency resolution engine in Gradle is one of the most advanced, if not the advanced, engine out there today, which is great, but also sometimes makes it hard to understand what's really going on. As with many things in Gradle, there are certain core functionalities that Gradle brings you that you can use in many flexible ways, and then there's additional things added by plugins. So today we will look at how things work in Java projects, but keep in mind that the general functionality can be used in any other kind of project as well. And as with many things in Gradle, you can tailor them to your own needs, which is something we'll talk about more in the future. But let's start by looking at some dependencies. If you declare a dependency in Gradle, you often see two or three parts. The third part at the end is a version, which you sometimes see and sometimes you don't. You only need versions for components that are published and come with different versions. Versioning, and especially dealing with version conflicts, is a big topic on its own. Today, I would like to focus on the other aspects of declaring dependencies, so we'll leave the versions away from now, and I'll just shortly comment on that in the end of this video. So let's look at the other two parts. The first thing you define is a so-called configuration. Gradle borrowed this term, configuration, from Ivy, on which the initial dependency resolution engine was based. The term is very generic, and so it's very hard to grasp. So in this context, we can also think about this as a scope or a bucket where you put in dependencies that have a certain meaning or a certain area where they apply. Now, all of this is flexible. In Gradle Core, nothing of this is fixed. But if you apply one of the Java plugins, Java library or application, you get a couple of configurations that are pre-configured by Gradle. So you have a number of scopes or buckets that you can use to define dependencies. If you work outside of Java, you could also define these yourselves. But to understand why different scopes or buckets are needed at all, we'll look at what the Java plugin provides in a minute. The second part of the dependency declaration are the coordinates, which are made up by a group and a name. So each component you want to reuse has these two properties to uniquely identify it. It can be a component from an external repository, or it can be something local which you define in another subproject of your own build, or in a project or subproject of another build you include. The nice thing is that at the moment you declare a dependency, it does not necessarily matter if something is a local project or something that is published. In my video about the settings file, I said that in the settings file, we tell Gradle the locations where to look for other components your components depend on. So at the moment of dependency declaration, it does not really matter where the component is located. Gradle will search for it and look for it in all the locations you defined in the settings file, whether it is a repository or another build. And this is only done as soon as the dependencies are needed. For example, to compile your application or to run it. So let's get back to our example. Before we start declaring dependencies, I want to add two little things. First, let's go to our convention plugin and define a group for our own components so that we can also address them by coordinates. To actually allow this, we also need to self-include our own build in the settings file, which you have to do for backward compatibility reasons. There is no harm in doing this. Then in our settings files, we also included another build called my other project. So let's put a subproject into this build as well, which we call shared utils, which also uses our convention plugin so that it gets the same group that we just defined there. So now we are all set to declare some dependencies. Let's go to our business logic project and use that as an example. The Java library plugin adds five different configurations for declaring dependencies. So we have five different scopes, buckets available. The most important one is called implementation. It tells Gradle that the component you are depending on is available at compilation and runtime of the library. We add a couple of dependencies in the implementation scope, an external utility we want to use, a logging API, our own utility, which we defined in the other project, and our data model, which we can also refer to by coordinates now. Alternatively, you could use the project notation here we've also used before. It's up to you which one you want to use. In the good case, there is no difference. The main difference is that if there is a problem in the build, Gradle can give you a better error message when it knows that you are looking for a project here. The next configuration that you might need to use a few times is API. API means that as with implementation, the dependency is available to build and run this library we are building here, the business logic library. But it means that the dependency is also visible to consumers of these libraries, so other components that depend on the library will transitively see this dependency during compilation, because, as the name of this configuration says, it's part of the API of the library I'm building here. So we change the dependency to our data model to API because we actually use it in the public API of the Java class we have written. When we compile our application that depends on the business logic, the application will also automatically see our data model at compilation time. It won't see, however, all the other things we have declared at implementation. Only at runtime, everything will be visible. So there are three more configurations for declaring dependencies which you should be careful with using. Two of them are quite similar, which are compile-only and compile-only API. As the name says, this dependency will only be used at compilation and not available at runtime. There are not too many cases where you need this. One is when you use things like annotation libraries that are not needed at runtime anymore. The other thing is if your application runs somewhere in some kind of container where certain dependencies are already provided through the runtime. But that's all information Gradle doesn't know, so you should be very careful when you use these scopes. So one situation where we could use this is when we use a tool like ErrorProne that comes with an annotation library. These annotations are just interpreted by the ErrorProne tool itself and are thrown away at runtime anyway. You could define this at compile-only or also as compile-only API so that it gets visible transitively to other consumers, which might be needed if other annotation processors run further up the dependency chain that encounter this annotation on public API and give a warning or an error if they see annotations where they can't find the class. The final configuration for declaring dependencies is runtime only. As the name says, these are dependencies that are only available at runtime, so when the code is compiled, these things are not visible. This is actually useful if something provides an API independent of the runtime, like the SLF4J API we have used here already. When we run this library and don't add anything else, we'll get a warning that the logger can't work because there's no logging implementation available, which is fine if we don't want to log. We can leave the choice of which logging implementation to use to the final consumer, which is in our case, the application or app project. So if we go into the build script there, we can declare a runtime only dependency to the logging implementation we want to use. As a summary of this, we can look at this diagram from the Gradle documentation. The things marked in green here are the configurations available to declare dependency, which we have just used in the example. By the arrows, you can see which of these end up in the compile class path and in the runtime class path. These are the things that Gradle actually uses when it needs the dependencies. So when the Java compile task runs, it resolves the compile class path, which means it takes all the dependencies you have declared in the scopes that are included in the compile class path, finds and downloads them. The runtime class path is then used when you actually run the application, also when you collect all the jars for packaging your application in a zip like we have done last time. Then there's also the API elements and runtime elements configuration visible. This shows you which dependencies are re-exported or made visible transitively. To illustrate this, we can also ask Gradle to show us the runtime or the compile class path for the example we've just built. For that, Gradle offers the dependencies tasks. So if we run it for a business logic project and ask it to show us the compile class path, we can see how all the components we have declared as implementation or API dependencies are available. If we ask for the compile class path of our application project, we can see how certain components, like our shared utils, are not visible anymore because they are not re-exported by the business logic project. But, for example, our data model is visible because we declared this API in business logic and thus it's re-exported and visible. But if we ask for the application runtime class path, we can see how suddenly everything is visible except for the annotation library we declared compile only. The output we see here is what Gradle uses directly as input for tasks that work in the Java plugin. like the compile task that uses the compile class path, or the run task that uses the runtime class path. We also used the runtime class path ourselves last time when we declared our own zip task to package our application. So just to clarify some terminology again, if we look back at this picture, all these squares are called configurations. The green ones are configurations to declare dependencies. The blue ones are resolvable configurations, like a runtime class path. And the light red ones are called consumable configurations, because they express what another project or another component that depends on myself can consume from what I provide. So there are certainly much more details on this topic, and we'll talk about it again. For now, you should remember that this is what Java plugin sets up. If you don't apply it, these won't be available, but the concept of configurations and configurations that you use for declaration, for resolving, and for consuming is available in Gradle Core. So you can create configurations yourself and wire them together as you like. For example, the compile-only API configuration actually just became available recently out of the box. But before, you were already able to define it yourself with a few lines of script code. Also remember that Gradle knows how everything is connected. If you use the runtime class path, Gradle will automatically download dependencies from repositories, but also trigger other builds, like our shared utility build, if required. This also allows you to change where components are located. So if we decide to publish our shared util library to a repository, Gradle could fetch it from there, and we don't even need to change the coordinates in the dependency. Which brings me back to the topic of versions. We'll go much more into that in the next video. I just want to quickly show you what I did today so that our examples actually worked. So generally, there are different approaches and patterns where and how to declare versions of dependencies in Gradle. One of the simplest things is to use our convention plugin for it, because that's where we do central build configuration anyway. There might be good reasons to do it differently, and we'll talk about it next time. But what I did today is I added a so-called dependency constraints block. You can think about it this way. If we don't tell anything about the version, and Gradle encounters a component that is available in a different version, it doesn't know what to do, because basically all versions are equally correct from Gradle's perspective. But if we add a constraint, we give some weight on which versions Gradle should prefer. The default notation, which I used here, where I just use the group name and then add the version with a colon, means I require this version, but a higher version is also okay, which is important for conflict resolution. Here we don't have conflicts, so Gradle will just take the versions we defined here. The takeaway for now is already that you should put the versions in a central place. In the end, if you put everything together into an application, you can only have one version of a certain thing, so you should use that one version everywhere. That's why I recommend not to put any versions in the build scripts, but just the components you depend on by their group name coordinates. We'll talk about the options you have to put the versions in a central place in the next video. See you then.